Good afternoon, students. Hope you all are healthy and safe at home. So today we are going to learn about intestinal nematodes. So the start with this outline or objectives of this particular class that we should be able to understand at the end of this particular theory class, general properties of nematodes, classification of nematodes, which are the large intestine nematodes, small intestinal nematode, the life cycles, clinical features, disease cost, and laboratory diagnosis of these particular nematodes. So today we are going to learn about Ascaris lumbricoides, Ankylostoma duodenale, Nectar americans, and Strongyloides staphylorales in this particular class of intestinal nematodes. So to start with the introduction, you must have learned about the introductory part of this nematodes. Nematodes belongs to the phylum Nematoda. They live in intestinal tract or tissue of humans. They are non-segmented cylindrical worms appearing at both the ends, having a shiny, tough cuticle, acellular cuticle skin, which may be smooth, spine, or rigid. The digestive system is complete, having mouth, esophagus, intestine, and anus. Sexes are separate, so male and female are separate worms. So adult male is smaller than adult female worm and having a posterior end curve. Female are of three different forms. When they lay the eggs, fertilized eggs can be laid, which are known as oviparous. Fertilized eggs which lay and hatch immediately, these type of female worms are known as ovoviviparous. And those female worms which can lay or produce larva directly, they are known as viviparous. And this can be an MCQ question. Which type of female is viviparous, ovoviviparous, and oviparous? So viviparous means those directly give birth to the larva. Oviparous means those first produce the egg, eggs are laid, and they hatch after a particular time period. And ovoviviparous means eggs are laid which hatch immediately. So these are the different three forms of nematode females, intestinal nematode females. So nematodes are probably the most widespread animal group occurring in the world. Many of them are non-pathogenic and exist as free living forms in fresh or marine water and soil. While few of the species can be pathogenic, and exist as parasitic form in both animals and females. The systemic classification is based on Anderson et al. And they have the phylum Nematoda, which has two classes, Adenophora and Sirenita, which are different in many ways. So class Adenophora and Sirenita can be differentiated. Adenophora doesn't have sensory structures, and Sirenita, they have this sensory structure. Esophagus is modified with presence of glands and reserve organs in Adenophora, and that is normal in appearance in Sirenita. Excretory organs are without lateral canals in Adenophora and having these lateral canals seen in Sirenita. Carrion pulpae that is present in Adenophora, and carrion pulpae is absent in Adenophora and present in Sirenita. Infective form of the definitive host is first stage larva in case of Adenophora and third stage larva or embryonated egg in case of Sirenita. Okay, so this is, and based on their habitat, they can be again classified. Most of the nematodes inhabit in the intestine, while some of them, for example, filarial worm, reside in various tissue. So based on the, again, they can be divided on the basis of their capacity to lay the eggs or larva. Based on their these laying eggs or larva depositing capacity, they can be classified into oviparous, viviparous, and ovoviviparous. We have seen that. So example of oviparous is hookworm and Trichostrongylus species, where the eggs are unsegmented. Eggs are with unsegmented ovum is the Ascaris species. This is oviparous. Most of the nematode are oviparous, and following fertilization, the female worm produces eggs that takes some time to hatch out to form the larva in the environment. And example of eggs with segmented ovum, hookworm and Trichostrongylus species. Then another example is eggs with unsegmented ovum, Ascaris species. And eggs with unsegmented ovum with mucus plugs as both the poles, Tricheris species and capillary species. And eggs containing larva that takes some time to hatch out are the Entrobius species. Viviparous, that is female worms directly give birth to the larvae. There is no egg stage. Example is filarial worm, Trichinella species and Trichonopoulos species. Ovoviviparous, that means female worms lay eggs containing larva that immediately hatch out. Example is Strongyloides species. So this is about the differentiation on basis of their egg laying or producing larva characteristics. Okay. So we'll see the classification on basis of nematodes habitat, that is their small intestinal. And today we are going to learn about these only small intestinal Ascaris, small intestinal nematode. In that example is Ascaris lumbricoides and Colostoma duodenale, Nectar americans, Strongyloides stercoralis, Trichinella spiralis, Capillaria filipens. Out of these, which we are going to learn Ascaris lumbricoides and Colostoma duodenale, Nectar americans and Strongyloides stercoralis. So let's see. So mode of ingestion of these nematodes, generally there are various modes of infection. First is ingestion, penetration of skin through blood sucking insect, and through inhalation. So ingestion is mode of infection, one of the mode of infection, where embryonated eggs are along with the contaminated food and drinks are consumed by the host. This can be the route of infection for Ascaris lumbricoides, Entrobius vermicularis and Trichuris trichura. Second form, growing embryos in an intermediate host. For example, a cyclo is infected with Trachonopoulos medinensis, and that cyclo containing growing embryo, if consumed by the human through food or drinking water, can get infected. Encysted embryos along with the infected pig's flesh, this can be seen in Trichinella spiralis. Penetration of the skin can be seen in Ankylostoma duodenalis, Stercoralis and Nectar americans, where the filary form larva burrows through the skin, penetrate the skin, and they can infect the host. In case through blood-seeking insect, seen in case of filarial worms. Inhalation will act as a route of infection when the infected dust containing embryonated eggs is inhaled. The host get infected, and this can be seen in case of Ascaris lumbricoides and Entrobius vermicularis. So intestinal nematodes, first is the Ascaris. Ascaris lumbricoides is the largest nematode parasitizing human intestine. The name is derived from Ascaris, that means the intestinal worm, and lumbricus means resembling with the common earthworm. And that's why it is commonly known as round worm. So, epidemiologically, this is cosmopolitan in distribution, mainly affecting tropical countries, including India, estimated that 1,470 million people are infected globally, out of which around 120 to 250 million people are symptomatic. Transmission typically occurs through fecally contaminated soil and is due to either lack of sanitary measures, facilities, or use of human feces as a fertilizer. Clay soil are the most favorable for the development of Ascaris eggs, in contrast to the moist, porous soil required for hookworm. Risk factors: children, most important, disseminator of the disease, and malnourished one. So morphologically, before going to the morphology and life cycle of this, take a brief look at this particular, or first we'll see the morphology. Appearance is pinkish in color of the adult bone, which is freshly passed from the intestine, but gradually fades color and looks whitish. Size of female worm measures about 20 to 40 centimeter, which is a oviparous female. Size of male measures from 15 to 30 centimeters. Lifespan of adult worm is about 1 to 2 years. They are cylindrical, hence called roundworm, having tapering ends. Mouth opens anteriorly and bears 3 characteristic tooth, lips, 1 dorsal, 2 ventricle. And these characteristic tooth lip are usually differentiate between Ascaris numericoides and Ascaris sub. The body cavity is filled with characteristic fluid called as ascaron or ascaris, in which the intestine and genital organ floats. This fluid is irritant in nature, and if leaked, then can cause allergic manifestation. Male having posterior end curved, pointed, having 2 spicules, rectum and genital duct open together and play open near the posterior. Female posterior end is spread and pointed, and this is a subterminal and situated posteriorly, while vulva is situated at the junction of anterior and middle third of the body. Eggs are of 2 types, liberated from the female worm, Ascaris numericoides, 1 fertilized and unfertilized egg. Sometimes the fertilized egg may lose thick mammariated albuminous coat, such type of eggs are called as decorticated eggs. There are 4 stages of larva, larva 1 to larva 4. So this is about the morphology of this particular worm. Brief: Ascaris numericoides, adult worm, male to male, measuring about 15 to 30 centimeters. Female measures about 20 to 40 centimeters. Females are oviparous. Eggs are bile stained, measure about 60 micrometer. They are having albuminous coat with unsegmented ovum. Infective form: embryonated egg. Mode of transmission: ingestion, rarely inhalation. Site of localization: small intestine. So life cycle: host involves only one, that is human. Infective stage: embryonated eggs containing larva 2. Mode of transmission: ingestion of contaminated eggs from the contaminated soil, food, and water. Okay. So the migratory phase, where following ingestion the eggs hatch out to liberate larva 2, which measures about 250 micrometer long in the duodenum. This larva 2 mold once into larva 3 and penetrate the intestine, reach the right side of heart via portal circulation, and finally enter the lung via pulmonary capillaries. Within 6 to 10 days in lungs, the larva matures and become 550 micrometer long, mold to form the next stage larva, that is larva 4. The larva break up into alveoli, migrate via bronchi, trachea, and pharynx, and finally swallowed to reach the intestine. Intestinal phase: where the larva undergo final molt to develop into adult molt in the small intestine. Adults become sexually mature, fertilize, and the female worm start laying fertilized eggs which are passed in the feces. Sometimes before mating, the female worms may directly lay the unfertilized eggs, which is known as pre-patent period. In this time, the eggs ingested, it is the time from eggs ingestion to eggs passage, and this phases is pre-patent period is the time when the eggs are ingested, and from this time to the egg passed in the phases, and this time period is about 8 to 12 weeks. Okay, so we'll see the in short life cycle here. That is, adult male and female, they are in the small intestine. Female produce the eggs that are passed in the host feces. Single female can produce about 2 lakhs eggs per day, and this can be an MCQ. And these larvae in the eggs get mature into infective second stage larva. Then these eggs containing infective second stage larva are ingested by the host, and these eggs get hatched in the small intestine, and the larvae L3, they penetrate the tissues of the intestine and enter the bloodstream, and these larvae then migrate to the lungs and molt into third stage juvenile larva, and third stage juvenile migrate from the pulmonary capillaries into alveoli, air sacs, and there they are cuffed up and again swallowed, and they complete their development in the small intestine. Okay. So pathogenicity and clinical feature, Ascaris infection, Ascaris lumbricoides, causes ascariasis. Majority of infections are asymptomatic. Clinical disease is largely restricted to individuals with high worm load, and symptoms divided into two groups, those produce migratory larva and adult worms. Symptoms and complications. Symptoms produced by migrating larva: pneumonia, that is called Lofler syndrome, fever, cough, dyspnea, blood tinge, sputum that may contain larva, articarial rash, and eosinophilia. Visceral larva migrants is caused when larva enter systemic circulation, form pulmonary capillaries to reach other organs like brain, spinal cord, heart, kidney, and usually seen as a massive infection, usually seen when the infection is massive. Symptoms and clinical complications that produced by adult worm: abdominal discomfort, anorexia, nausea, and diarrhea, PM, vitamin A deficiency, night blindness, intestinal obstruction, particularly in children with 1 to 5 years of age, intussusception, and bulbus. Penetration through intestinal ulcer, cause perforation, peritonitis, hypersensitivity reaction to the worm antigens, toxic body fluid, which can cause urticaria, edema of the face, conjunctivitis, irritation of urethra. Pathogenicity and clinical features. Symptoms produced by adult worm: ectopic ascariasis. Due to migration of the worm into the stomach, it may be vomited out, pass through the esophagus at night time, and comes out through the mouth or nose, and then enter the larynx and cause apraxia. Again, they can migrate to other organs and cause appendicitis, cholecystitis, biliary coli, cholangitis, and pancreatitis. In the laboratory diagnosis, first, the direct detection of the worm or worms in the stool or vomit. which is macroscopic identification or macroscopic detection. Occasionally, adult worm may be detected in the stool or sputum of the patient by naked eyes. Microscopic detection, direct examination of the feces following flotation methods, can demonstrate bile stained eggs. Eggs may not be seen at least 40 days after infection, and blood examination can show eosinophilia. So, egg detection, both fertilized and unfertilized eggs can be detected by stool examination by saline and iodine wet mount, where we can differentiate between both these eggs. Saline and iodine mount eggs can be differentiated. We can have the question also here about differentiation of these eggs, saline and iodine mount eggs can be differentiated. How they can be differentiated? I hope you have all gone through that. So next is imagining. Large collection of worm can be seen through imagining in the abdominal. USG can show hepatobiliary or pancreatic ascariasis. Serology, antibody detection, mainly reserved for epidemiological studies. Treatment is mebendazole, albendazole, drug of choice, but contraindicated in pregnancy and heavy infection. Parenteral PAMO, single doses given. Letrozine citrate in suspected intestinal or biliary obstruction. Since this drug paralyzes the worm, aid expulsion. And levomisole. These are the drugs of choice. Prevention. Good sanitation and personal hygiene, fast treatment with single dose mebendazole or albendazole for school age children every 3 to 4 months, several dual functions, treats the children and reduces the overall worm burden in the community. Next organism is Ankylostoma duodenale. The next parasite is the Ankylostoma duodenale. Or which is also known as hookworm, which is one of the most important cause of iron deficiency anemia in both tropics and temperate countries. It is also named because the anterior end of the adult worm is bent. Hookworm belongs to the family Ankylostomidae, which consists of two species which infect human, Ankylostoma duodenale and Nectar americans. The word ankylostoma is derived from the hooked mouth, ankylos, hooked, stoma, mouth. Human parasites, Ankylostoma duodenale, or which is also known as old world hookworm, and Nectar americans, which is also known as new world hookworm. And animal parasites that rarely infect human cause cutaneous larva migraines. This can be an MCQ. Ankylostoma brasiliensis, Ankylostoma canium, Ankylostoma selenium, and we shortly look about the history of this parasite. It was first detected in Italian physician Dubin, detected by the Italian physician Dubin in 1843, and its life cycle pathogenesis was discussed by Arthur Loss in 1898. Nectar americans was first described by Stittis in 1902 in Texas, USA, and hence called American hookworm. It is widely spread globally. Nearly 900 million people are infected. Nectar americans infecting 835 million people, more common than Ankylostoma duodenale. which infect 135 million. Ankylostomum duodenale prevalent in southern Europe, North Africa, Northern Asia, and Native Americans is the predominant species in Western world. Hookworm infection almost eradicated from Europe and USA. Male and young adults aging 25 are commonly affected, but anemia is maybe due to iron loss. It's more severe in children and pregnant. In India, hookworm infection is widely prevalent. More than 200 million people are estimated to be infected in India. Nectar americans is predominant in South India, as Ankylostoma duodenale in North India. Nectar americans is seen in all states except the Punjab and Uttar Pradesh. So, heavily infected areas in India are Assam, Tea Gardens, West Bengal, Bihar, Odisha, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, and Maharashtra. There is one term which is called as endemic index, Chandler's index. It is used in epidemiological studies of hookworm disease to estimate the morbidity and mortality in the community from hookworm infection, which depends much upon the worm load. Morphology of adult worm measures about 5 to 11 millimeter, then female measures about 9 to 13 millimeter. Females are oviparous. Shape is stripped except the anterior end, which is bent dorsally, hence called hookworm. Color is pinkish or grayish white, but mostly look reddish due to ingestion of blood. Mouth is present anteriorly, contains buccal capsule bearing 6 teeth, 4 hook like tooth on ventral surface and 2 knob like teeth dorsally. Eggs are oval in shape, measure 60 micrometer long into 40 micrometer wide, non-bile stained, colorless eggs surrounded by a thin eyeline translucent egg shape, you can see in the picture. Ovum is segmented. They are having 4 blastomas. There is a clear space between egg shell and the embryo. Floats on saturated salt solution, and eggs of both duodenale and nectar americans are morphologically indistinguishable. Larvae are there, stages of larvae are there, first stage, second stage to fourth stage. First stage larva is called rapidity form larva, first stage larva is called filary form larva, and the infective form for human is the third stage larva, that is the filary form larva, which measures about 600 to 660 to 720 micrometer. Rapidity form larva, which is the first stage larva, measures about 100 to 150 micrometer. The esophageal bulb extend to about 1/3 of the body length, and posterior end is more acutely tapered. The rapidity form larva of Ankylostoma duodenale and Nectar americans is morphologically similar, but it can be different morphology of the filary form larva. So filary form larva are different of both of them, not the rapidity form larva. So, in short, we'll see the brief. Adult worm, male measures 8 to 11 millimeter, female 10 to 13 millimeter, female is oviparous, eggs measuring about 60 micrometer, non-bile stain, colorless, segmented, having 4 blastomas, having a thin, high-line, translucent egg shell. There's a clear space between the egg shell and the embryo. Infective form is the third stage of filary form larva of Ankylostoma duodenale as well as Nectar americans. Mode of infection, penetration of the skin, and site of localization is small intestine. Okay. Sites of skin penetration, common sites are thin skin between the toes, dorsum of the feet, inner side of the sole, that we see in gardeners and miners, that is skin of hams. So life cycle, host involves only one host, that is human. Infective stage is the third stage filary form larva. Mode of transmission through penetration of the skin by the third stage larva, by walking, barefoot in dampened soil through rare, though rare, but other routes of transmission of larva has been reported through oral, in utero and transmammary routes. Migratory phase following penetration, L3, that is phyliriform larva, enter into small subcutaneous venules through venous circulation, reach to the right side of heart and finally to the lungs. Here they enter into alveolar space and migrate up to bronchi, trachea, and finally swallowing of the sputum, they enter GIT. Intestinal phase, development into adult, the L3 larva undergo third molt either in the migratory phase or after reaching the esophagus and transform into L4 larva that reaches to the small intestine and where they undergo to the final molt to develop into adult. Next step is laying eggs. The adult worms attach to the intestinal mucosa by their teeth and buccal capsule. In about 5 months following infection, the adult worm matures and then following fertilization, female worm start laying the eggs, which are excreted in the feces. A gravid female of Ankylostoma duodenale can lay 10,000 to 25,000 eggs per day. Remember, this can be a MCQ. Whereas that of Nectar Americans can lay 5,000 to 10,000 eggs per day. A female worm survives about 1 year of Ankylostoma duodenale and 3 to 5 years of Nectar Americans. Development in the soil. Embryonation takes place in moist, sandy and warm soil. The first stage, that is the rhabditiform larva, hatch out from eggs, which then molt twice, and finally infective stage, that is L3 larva, are developed within 5 to 8 days and then remain viable in the soil for several weeks. Pathogenesis. So for quick review, we can see life cycle here. Okay, can start from this, eggs in the feces, eggs get swallowed in this step, and then after 48 hours rhabditiform larva hatches into eggs, hatch out the rhabditiform larva. This rhabditiform larva within next 6 to 8 days transform into phyliriform larva, that is the third stage. Infective form larva for humans, this larva penetrate the skin, enters into circulation, from circulation goes to the lungs, from lungs to trachea, trachea to pharynx, and again gets swallowed and reaches through GIT to the small intestine, where they develop into mature male and female. Then female become fertilized and again lays the egg, and eggs are again passed in the stool. And the total cycle takes about 6 to 8 weeks. From external environment to humans, these are the two forms of the cycle. Okay. This is the picture showing hookworms in the intestine. So, pathogenicity and clinical features. Hookworm has ability to suck the blood from the intestinal vessel. It attaches and making cuts in the intestinal wall by buccal capsule and teeth, followed by sucking the blood through contraction of the muscle, muscular esophagus, secreting hydrolytic enzyme, releasing anticoagulants like factor 7A, tissue factor inhibitors, ingestion of extra vasated blood. It can also penetrate the skin, which is facilitated by proteolytic enzymes like aspartic protease and hyaluronidase secreted by the hookworm. It is postulated that hookworm infection can protect the individual from asthma, malaria, but predisposed to human immunodeficiency virus, HIV, tuberculosis and other intestinal helminthic infections. Ankylostomiasis or hookworm disease characterized by iron deficiency anemia, and we have seen why it is caused. Why it is caused? Because attaching and making cuts in the intestinal wall by buccal capsule and teeth, followed by sucking the blood through contraction of the muscular esophagus of the parasite. They secrete adenolytic enzyme releasing anticoagulants like factor 7A and tissue inhibiting factors, and also the ingestion of extravasated blood. So these may be the reason for this. Majority infections are asymptomatic. Symptoms develop in heavy infection and divide into groups, those produced by migrating larva and adult worms. So clinical features. Symptoms produced by the larva: lesions in the skin, ankylostoma, dermatitis or crown ridge. Occurs at the site of entry, more common in Nectar americans, lasts 2 to 4 weeks, creeping eruption, reddish itchy papule along with the path by phyllariform larva, migraines, lesions in the lungs, bronchitis and bronchopneumonia. Symptoms produced by adult worm: epigastric pain, diarrhea and vomiting during early phase of infection, microcytic hyperchromia, iron deficiency anemia due to chronic blood loss. A single adult worm sucks 0.2 ml of the blood per day, hemorrhages from punctured sites. Clinical features of hookworm anemia: extreme pallor, abnormal appetite showing pica or geophagia, that is perverted taste for earth, mud or lime, epigastric tenderness with dyspepsia, constipation, puffy face with swelling of lower eyelids, pedal edema, growth retardation, general appearance is pale, plumpy with protuberant abdomen and dry, lustreless hair. Laboratory diagnosis: demonstration of the eggs in stool by stool examination. It shows non-bile stain eggs and those are segmented, having 4 blastomas. Occult blood stool is positive. Blood examination shows anemia and eosinophil. Treatment is mebendazole, albendazole, oral iron replacement with ferrous sulfate 400 mg, nutritional support. These are the treatment for this. Prevention: proper sanitation measures, sewage disposal, personal hygiene, personal protection, wearing boots and gloves, simultaneous treatment of carriers and deceased with wholesale treatment of community. Next is Strongyloides stercoralis. Strongyloides stercoralis was known as the military worm, as it was first found in Los Normand in 1876 in the feces of French soldier in Cochin, China. The life cycle and pathogenicity were described later during 90s, and the name was coined by Stittis and Hassel in 1902. Strongyloides belongs to the superfamily Rhabdoidea, the family Strongyloidea, and comprises 53 species, but human infection is mainly caused by Strongyloides stercoralis and rarely by Strongyloides fuliborni. Epidemiologically, it is endemic in tropics and subtropics, distributed in hot, humid tropical areas, including India, Sub-Saharan Africa, and South America, Brazil. About 5 million people are infected worldwide. Habitat: parasitic female resides in the human intestine, duodenum, and jejunum, whereas the free-living female worms multiply in the environment. Male worms are always free-living. The existence of parasitic male worm is debatable for many years. Most believe that the parasitic male worm do not exist. However, some school thought though believe that they may exist and fertilize the female but don't have penetrating power. Adult And Staudinger distichoral is existing two forms, adult and larva. Adult can be parasitic or free living, as we have seen. Parasitic adults, male worms are not demonstrated in humans because they cannot penetrate the intestinal wall, unlike females. So eliminated from the bowel by the time female lays the eggs. Female lives in the small intestine. Parasitic adult worm measures about 2.5 millimeter to 0.04 to 0.5 millimeter. And they have small buccal cavity with four lips surrounded. Females have two uteri filled with 10 to 20 eggs at a time. Female is ovoviviparous. Eggs are thin-shelled, 55 to 30 micrometer. Lays in tissue. Rapidity form larva hatches immediately and makes its way to lumen of intestine. So free living adults, they live in moist soil. Females 1 millimeter long and male 0.7 millimeter long. Mate in soil, fertilized female lay the eggs that hatches to release the rapidity form larva. Rapidity form larva passed with feces, measures about 200 to 300 into 16 micrometer. These are actively motile, have small mouth and characteristic double. Bulk esophagus, life cycle is simple, requires only one host mode of transmission following contact with the fecally contaminated soil or auto-infection. Infective forms are phyliriform larva. This penetrates the intact skin or mucous membranes, travels through bloodstream to the lungs, bronchial tree, crawl over epiglottis and then are swallowed to reach the small intestine. Life cycle in small intestine, where they get matured into adult. Female lays the egg by parthenogenesis, a type of fertilization where female lays the eggs which produce larva without being fertilized by the male worm or fertilization by the male. Eggs hatch locally in the intestine to release rapidity form larva which migrates to intestinal lumen. This rapidity form larva either pass with the stool or develops into phyliriform larva in the lumen. These then can cause auto-infection by penetrating the mucosa or perianal skin. Larvae in the soil can develop by two ways. One, they can get mature into infective form larva. Second, develop into free-living adult male and female. Male worm fertilizes the female and it lays eggs in the soil. Rapidity form larva hatches out and develop into phyliriform and infect humans by penetration and continue their life cycle. Can see here the life cycle is much complicated. Okay. So phyliriform larva, which is the infective form larva, you can see here, it penetrates the skin, larva reaches in the blood, larva pass through Larva passes through, similar to that of Ascaris, reaches to the intestine, develops into adult worm in the intestine. Female lays the eggs. Eggs hatches, rapidity form larva is released in the feces, through the feces in the soil, or there may be. Now we will see there are three types of life cycles, auto-infection, direct and indirect. So first is direct, where the contaminated soil is, where the particular larva is released in the soil and they develop into phyliriform larva in the soil and from there they penetrate the skin. This is the direct life cycle. Again, they reach to the blood, from there they follow the life cycle as is seen in Ascaris, which is the intestine, develop into adult worm. Adult worm fertilized, female lays the eggs, and again indirect cycle. In indirect cycle, when the rapidity form larva released by feces in the soil, they turn into adult in the feces, in the soil only, where the male fertilizes the female, female produces the eggs, again eggs develop into first stage rhabditiform larva, rhabditiform larva again develop into phyllariform larva, the infective form for human, and again the life cycle continues. And in auto-infection, rhabditiform larva, which is in the intestine, it is auto-infected. Auto-infection occur, rhabditiform larva develop into phyllariform larva, and this phyllariform larva penetrate the intestine and again reaches to the blood circulation. Okay, understand? So man gets infection by penetration of the skin by the phyllariform larva, that is L3. It reaches to the venous circulation, goes to the lungs and trachea, from there to bronchi and larynx, from there to pharynx, gets swallowed, reaches to the small intestine, molt, into adult male and female, adult female in the small intestine, these the eggs. These eggs develop into rhabditiform, develop the rhabditiform larva in the intestine, and then phyllariform larva, and then adult worm in the environment, in indirect male female, in again male female fertilization takes place, and eggs are developed in the soil, rhabditiform larva in the soil develop into rhabditiform phyllariform larva, infective form for human, in the soil. This is indirect development in the soil. In case of direct development in the soil, when where the phyllariform larva directly infect the human by penetrating the skin, and in auto infection, this rhabditiform larva in the intestine develop into phyllariform larva in the intestine, and auto infection occurs. So this is how the life cycle of Strangulitis stercorallis. Clinical feature: larva occurrence. Migrating larva produces a pruritic raised erythematous lesion that advances along the course of its migration. Larva occurrence: running larva may advance as rapid as 10 cm per hour. It can also produce hemorrhagic lesions in the lungs. Burrowing adults can cause mild epigastric pain resembling peptic ulcer. Other manifestations include nausea, diarrhea, gastrointestinal bleeding, colitis, weight loss. Eosinophilia is a common and presumptive diagnostic feature. Laboratory diagnosis: stool examination may demonstrate rhabditiform larva. They can be demonstrated in stool by direct microscopy or following concentration techniques. Sometimes hookworm eggs may hatch into stool, releasing rhabditiform larva, which has to be differentiated from that of Strongyloides stercorallis. Single stool examination is less sensitive, 30%, due to irregular and low output of larva, hence repeated stool examination, 4 consecutive samples is required. Enterotest: sometimes duodenal aspirate can be collected by enterotest and examined for the presence of larva. Disseminated strongyloidiasis can be rapidly diagnosed by examination of stool, sputum, and other body fluids and tissue, which typically contain high numbers of phyllariform larva. Stool culture: freshly passed stool samples should be cultured. L3 stage larva, phyllariform larva, are formed within 2 days, which should be differentiated from that of hookworm. Various culture techniques can be used, including Harada Mori filter paper tube method, petri dish slant culture technique, Veermannen funnel technique, charcoal culture method, and agar plate technique, which is the most sensitive. Serology: ELISA using crude larval antigen has a great sensitivity up to 95%, and should be used when microscopic examinations are negative. However, it is less specific because cross-reactivity with the other helminthic infection. Antibody detection cannot detect between or differentiate between past and recent infection. Luciferase immune precipitation assay has been developed to detect IgG antibodies to recombinant Staphylococcus aureus immunoreactive antigen. It has sensitivity and specificity approaching 100%. Molecular diagnosis, real-time polymerase chain reaction to detect Staphylococcus DNA in fecal samples has been developed, and it has achieved 100% specificity and high sensitivity. Non-specific test includes eosinophilia, treatment and prevention, same as hookworm and other intestinal nematode. It is potentially life-threatening disease. Treat even if asymptomatic. Avoid contact with infective sites. Thiabendazole for 2 days, 25 mg per kg body weight, BAD. Disseminated spongiloides. In case of disseminated spongiloides, it has to be taken for 5 to 7 days until the parasites are eradicated. Okay, so here we have to stop for today's. The expected questions we'll see. Large answer questions for 15 marks can be asked on classify intestinal nematode, describe life cycle, pathogenesis and laboratory diagnosis of Staphylococcus aureus, describe the life cycle and pathogenesis laboratory diagnosis of hookworm. It can be asked short note on interviews for me, sorry, ascariasis. It can be asked differentiation between Ankylostoma duodenale and Nectar americans, Ankylostoma duodenale and Staphylococcus aureus binary form worm larva, Rhabditiform larva of Ankylostoma duodenale and Staphylococcus aureus, fertilized and unfertilized eggs of Ascaris, male and female worm of Ankylostoma duodenale. There are certain multiple choice questions. All of the following nematodes are oviparous except Staphylococcus aureus. Common name of Tristura is whipworm. Ascaris infects human by ingestion of embryonated eggs present in contaminated food and water. Larva occurrence is caused by Staphylococcus aureus. Thank you, students. I hope you understood. If you are not able to understand, you can reach to us anytime. Thank you so much.